And it's, of course, a particularly great pleasure for me to introduce my old boss and the reason we're here, Jens Rostrup Nielsen, who's going to give us a, he's told me, an overview of what he's been doing the last 50 years. And please, Jens, half an hour, remember?
Okay, first, I'm more than pleased that this symposium was organized, and thanks to Bert, thanks to John, and to ACS that they have put up the framework. I was surprised that a symposium like this could be arranged. But I think I'm very happy if I could function as a catalyst to get all of you together. In this presentation, I will just run through my experienced in these 50 years. The best things have been reported by other people, but I'll just try to put a few things in perspective. And then this afternoon, I will give another talk where I will talk about the lessons learned. But let us just start. And I was quickly after my education, I was associated with Topsurf, and very soon I got close to him, and it was a fantastic experience to work close to him, and because he had the attitude to research that we should do a multiple approach. It was not just to develop the catalyst processes and production methods, it was also to do research to understand what we were doing, and then to explore the research, what we find behind what the horizon, and then to develop new competences. Research to understand would mean that not just play the main theme with the right hand on the piano, but try to play with the left hand at the same time, and that would put things in more perspective. This was, of course, essential that we had an understanding of what we were doing, the problems, and we were to optimize, and we could play a more rational optimization of our catalyst manufacture and so forth. There was another purpose of doing this fundamental research as well. It was also to get a professional link to the academic world, to the research centers around, to the universities, and if you don't have something yourself, you may be offered an option at the faculty club that will have no real dialogue on science. We developed that very much, and some of you will find yourself on this photo, that we, on almost annual basis, there were scientific meeting arranged by us, where we discussed the principal questions in our catalysis development work. I was then put to work on steam forming process. There was a very active group at that time, and that was back in the lab. So Adler told me, Ed, couldn't you just find out what was going on? Because they knew how the reform was running, but really what happened inside the tube, there was very little knowledge around that time. So I started out at that time, you could say, the catalysis in the mid-60s. It was based mainly on the whole Watson book, Clinical Process Principles, people from Wisconsin. And then you had Southfield's role of fusion catalysis, and also, of course, the Kinetics Clinical Processes, also the bonds in the catalysis parameters. But that was what we had. I read myself the first book I read in catalysis was by a Russian. I learned from Russian colleagues later on that he was a Swedish fellow. But I was very much influenced about the book, because he spent many pages just describing that catalyst is not uniform surface, that you have all kinds of heterogeneities. And that had an impact on my work in the future. And not the least, he was also very much interested in the heterogeneities at the surface, and very late in his career he said that he could almost consider a cabinet party as a living object. And as we have had illustrated several times when we look in the electron microscope, for sure the cabinet particle changes shape depending on the reaction conditions. But all that had a great impact on me when I started out doing research. At that time, we also had a big discussion in the literature where you could predict catalysis from, say, bulk properties of materials, and you had particular dense down from CI and also bonds with this group. Promoting that. We are back in the 60s now, around 1970. And in opposition to that, you had Wolfgang Sackler and also Pavic, who came after the Russian invasion to the Czech Republic. And they argued in a very brutal way about the role of the individual surface atom. I was present at a discussion in the Institute of Petroleum in 71, and if you want to read something nice about the history and the theory of catalysis, you should look up that reference. They were arguing in a very tough way, and I was happy about it. I was not part of the discussion. I was influenced very much by Sackler, his way of looking on catalysis. And so when I started doing research on the reforming, I started really from the bottom. And that was to find out what is the active surface, how big is it, and that was the concepts. Not the trivial state, but it wasn't that at all in those days. Simply to refer the activity to the active surface area. That was introduced by Bond, and also by Michel, to low frequency and so forth. So we had at the same time a problem with sulfur poisoning, and we have discussed it several times during this symposium, but we were able to very quickly to establish a correlation between the saturation layer and the catalyst, the sulfur, and the surface area of the hydrogen capacity. So that led us to conclusion that sulfur poisoning was simply a blockage of the living surface. We saw also one of the early curves that depicted the saturation layer, very low coverage. That was followed up at the same time by a breakthrough in the other hydrogen techniques, the LEED, not at least the people in Paris, in the dark room, and later on, of course, with the tunneling microscopy, we have got all these things confirmed. These photo from the Wiesenbach group in August. Another thing I pursued was, of course, these ideas of the role of the heterogeneities on the metal surface. And what was very much in fashion at that time was the so-called B5 size. Introduced by Fernandez. And I had a correspondence with him because I had no infrared spectroscopy to determine the nitrogen adsorption, which was an indicator for the B5 size. But together we found out a method so we could do a volumetric thing to determine the number of B5 size. So I correlated the tracing activity with the nitrogen capacity, and plotted all data, and here you can see that it's like a drunken bomb pilot trying to build a railroad, and the only conclusion is that apparently you flew the right way. Later, we just took the data from the lunar calves, and then it looks much, much better. One interesting observation was that these B5 sites were absolutely blocked if we added alkali to the calves. Also, the rodent alkali, which was a promoter of many calves at that time, was studied when I studied compared ethane reforming, ethane being the simplest naphtha, with ethane hydrogenolysis. Ethane hydrogenolysis was, say, the reaction of fashion. John Sinfield did a lot of work on it. And here we could see that we had a very strict correlation between the activity of hydrogenolysis and the steam reforming of ethane. And the red dot, I think, was a catalyst with alkaline. So alkaline would, not the red dots, the bottom dots, are the alkaline promoted catalyst. And we saw that the alkaline would deactivate not only the steam reforming reaction, but also the hydrogenolysis. And in the hydrogenolysis reaction, you have no steam presence. So the role of alkaline was independent of the presence of steam. We compared then a number of reactions on a sequence of catalysts, which I think is a very nice way of getting an overview. So we could see that there was a parallel development of reforming and hydrogenolysis, although the temperatures were completely different. We could see that if you have alkali present, you get a drastic decrease in activity. After methylation of carbon monoxide, this effect was even more pronounced. Whereas when we did decomposition of ammonia, then there was no impact at all. After we got roughly the same relative activity. The role of alkali was a big debate. We had a lot of discussions with our colleagues or opponents of ICI. They claimed that alkali would work to promote, to inhibit carbon formation by being on the living surface. And said that we had spillover of steam from activated magnesium oxide, which was to support our catalyst. So there was a lot of debate. Every second year, I had a publication every second year. Bridger or Andrew had, and Dowden also, and later it was Twick and Ridler and Stitz, and also my younger colleagues. There was a big debate. The good thing was that we became, some of us, very good friends during this debate when we went to conferences. We could agree that those from universities, they had not understood the thing, but who should ask the critical question? That was in particular Andrew and Dow. I never met Bridger. Finally, we found out that it was not the alkali solution or the magnesium solution. In fact, there were two solutions to the equation. And later on, I met with Martin Twigg and Peter Morgan, we had a big laugh about that going forward. Whisker power was, of course, the real bad thing in steam reforming. We have learned a lot already, but if you form carbon, these carbon fibers so strong that the catalyst will break down and you will get a very difficult situation in a fire tubular reactor. I started studying this in a very simple TGA unit, which we designed from scratch. Today you can buy a TGA reactor, but we had to use a normal balance and put up everything. And it took us more than a year to have such a unit functioning. And what was in particular difficult was to establish a very controlled steam to carbon ratio. The trick was to create steam in vapor phase over carbon oxide, all kinds of and so on would be not be exactly. Here you see Ulla, who was working hard with a smile over 20 years for me on all these problems. Also, I had a lot of collaboration and discussions with David Trim. We found out that we studied in the same field, and instead of publishing against each other, we agreed to collaborate. And here we are sitting on the steps in Sydney, and steps were really the solution. Years after, all this could be explained by DMT calculations. We have seen this curve earlier, and as you can see, also it's clear that the most stable position for graphite is the arrow that is on the steps surface. So the solution was really that these step size played a crucial role. For me, it was nice to learn because it was a kind of confirmation of the role of the B5 size we had worked on in the 70s. We worked together with the industrial group and to try to really understand how a carbon would nucleate. And here you see the next group on the the left side, you have young yeast, his sister, and then you have Claire yeast, his nurse, and then you have old yeast, and Jan Clausen, who is now the CEO of the such a company, SDM, who is still at home, and then Frank Abbey as a young fellow here. So we could collaborate just to find the scientific solution for this. And of course, for us in the company, it was also a way to understand how we should promote the patents in the best way. So that resulted in this famous publication we have seen before. But that was a way in which Topsoe allowed us to collaborate with the university world. That was an open two-way dialogue built on trust, not on agreements and all these modern stuff. So the result, not going into details, that was what Frank Appel explained yesterday, was that carbon nucleates when you get a graphene chain more than 20 atoms, then the whisker can bang off, and that also what you could see in the movie, that the little crystal will change shape, and that the step size are formed during the reaction. This is something I think is a fantastic thing to observe, so you cannot just, as Michel said, consider a catalyst surface as a dead body. This of course also led us to the idea that the step size would be important for the promotion. Now we know that, for instance, the alkene will have a preferred absorption on step size. The same is true for sulfur, and so forth. This was the input from doing, say, fundamental research, to playing with the left-hand side at the same time as we played on the right-hand side. In real life, I spent a lot of time on the plants to look into the reformers to find out what went wrong. If something went wrong. The company had a special talent to send me to plants where there were big problems. So that was really an interesting thing to look into a reform and find out why you got these hot spots and hot bonds. And it was in fact from input from all these observations and the computer simulations of the operation that I got ideas to carry out experiments in the lab. Most of my experiments in the lab were inspired from what I saw in industry. So it was not a linear process that at first you do fundamental research and then scale up in a small lab and then finally pilot and then go up. It was really the feedback from the observations in industry. And then when we got spent catalysts back, or forensic investigations. I learned a lot from that, and not just from doing planned research. Now there is a limit to how much you can do in compliance part, you can call it customer service and so on, but that is a limit to how much you can play with it. So I, at one point I told Helga that we need to have a full-size or to a power plant because we can't get further. I need to determine the radial pivot. So for that we need a full-scale power plant. That was my dear friend and colleague, Lars Christiansen, who had built up these models on basis of work, not the least by Schiller for him. So when we did he called, first called the manager of our Houston office, no natural gas in Denmark, so we had to put it up in Houston. And he asked, how much would that cost? 1 million, he said. Okay, that's fine, we have 1 million. It turned out not to be 1 million kroner, but $1 million, that's a factor of seven. Okay. That went, that was his attitude, and with that power plant, we really then over the next 10-15 years learned a lot. I was not alone, we were a strong team of people. Here you see some of them, but you have some of the younger members not present in this photo being here today, and there are still young people, further young people coming in and taking over. The idea was then not to demonstrate what could be used in industry, but try to, as we were told yesterday, to find where is the cliff. Because if you know where a cliff is, it's not so dangerous to walk, say, 10 meters from the cliff. But if you walk there with your mother-in-law, she would not walk with you, say, half a mile from the cliff. And many have, say, general process engineers, they behave like that. So you really had to know where the cliff was. And we used the power plant very much to confirm what our calculations showed. And then, as we also have heard, to find out how far could we go to the carbon limits and could we cross the carbon limits. Each time we met the borderline, the challenge was, how can you break it? And we learned the next Ugar attempt, how we broke it with, by means of the so-called spark principle. And there again, it was with the left hand, we had played the science. We knew how the sulfur was on the surface, extremely well defined. We also had the capability of calculating the power rate. We knew the mechanism of carbon formation. We found out that when we had high sulfur coverages, we got this strange form of sulfur, which was from underneath, because that's completely different from what we see on the bottom. If you can't get well known by doing good science, you can always become relatively known by introducing new concepts. So in the paper, I just call this octopus carbon because it looks like an octopus. And then years after, all people will talk about octopus. The key experiment was, of course, again in the TGA equipment to measure at the same time the reforming rate, RR, and the carbon formation rate, RC, as function of the free mean surface. Now, notice there are completely different scales for the blue and the red curve. And then from a classical max test, deactivation kinetics, you will see that you have a double model in the diagram, you have the slope for the forming reaction close to 3, and for the carbon formation close to 6. It meant that, or 6.5, it meant that in that max test terminology, that you need an example of roughly 3 atoms for the reforming reaction and roughly 6-7 atoms for the carbon formation. And this led us then to say we have an ensemble control because when we add the sulfur carbon coverage, we will remove much faster the size of the carbon formation than the size for the reforming reaction. Now with the knowledge today, this is too simple an explanation. So we could say that what happens is that on the stiff side, we have sulfur atoms sufficient to inhibit that to create the carbon chain of 20 roughly 20 atoms to do it, and that you really have a sort of dynamic balance between the binding of the sulfur and the binding of the carbon, and together with the Nørskov group, we really could quantify that, and also scientifically, we could also arrive at the borderline for the sulfur perturbation. There's a certain some dynamic potential for carbon where it will, the carbon formation will win over the sulfur. All this is just an example of the way my colleagues and I, we like to work. And that was, as soon as we had an indication of things in these two well-defined base scale units, then to scale up the power plant, and the power plant meant operating with full mass velocity at the correct heat transfer rate. And it is at that scale you will always find the deactivation phenomena developing and so forth. And then scale down here by in situ, but you could say in general to do fundamental methods to understand what is on the surface, instead of doing tests in experimental units where you do not know whether you have the right catalyst temperature due to diffusion and you have a wrong heat transfer rate. So all this made the catalyst development process, say, a learning process. It's not again a linear, that first you do linear basic research and establish the mechanism and then you scale up. We were fast going into the pilot plant and then took the catalyst samples from the pilot plant and used all the advanced techniques to characterize them. And that gave us then new ideas to do new experiments in the power plant. Finally, when the catalyst came out into industry, we could take samples back in a very systematic way and then use all our fundamental characterization methods to describe what was going on. That was the way in which we built up our know-how around the reforming process. And that was also very much the philosophy used in our processes. If we talk about another one, about this methanation for SNG, methanation is just the reverse process, and after the first oil crisis, there was a big interest in making SNG, not the least in this country. A lot of work was being done, only one plant being built. But we here we as experienced in the sea reforming, we said it's a process engineers also, it is a question of getting a high temperature rise with the methanation, so we could utilize the process heat to superheat the steam. And so the first reactor will really have a very high temperature increase. Now there's a printing error of 2, 4, 600 degrees. So in the first reactor, we will take the methanation up to say 650 degrees, meaning that in the boiler downstream of that reactor, you could make superheated steam, which could be used for something useful. And then you had simple clean up methanators downstream. This was a tough requirement to the catalyst because the catalyst working at 650 degrees, maybe even half a year or longer, at one point as the catalyst would be poisoned, that central catalyst would then be able to act to work at, say, 300 degrees. We were lucky with our experience in the reforming that we could end up with a catalyst which at that time was unique. The crucial part was, of course, to understand the sintering mechanism, and at that time the knowledge was, the theories were very, very blurred, and there were wild discussions whether it was Oswald or whether it was coalescence, and and nobody had invented it. The big breakthrough came with these in situ electron microscopy investigations, where you could see that the same chemistry could have both mechanisms work, and that is dependent on the process conditions, whether you have one or the other mechanism. And but we found out how to control this censoring, and that brought us into the German ADA project. And I was so flattered that the reform was called Adam. You have here, no, the Eva. You have here the nuclear heated reformer, Eva, 950 degree Pascal. Then you have seen the bond process, and then you transport the syn gas. You could put the nuclear reactor far from populated areas, close to the Danish border, and then put the syn gas down to the populated parts of Germany and the Ruhrgebiet, and then have a reverse methanation, and with high temperature methanation we had developed, you could then make the superheated steam and make electricity. So the truth came when we came closer. Eva, there was no romance about that. It simply means Einzelrohrversuchsanlage. Versuchsanlage. So Adam, that was adiabatische Anlage during the year. So but we succeeded, and with the Jewish people, we had roughly 40,000 hours to run, and had already processed. And then the market disappeared. There's only one plant built in the United States, and nothing happened then for many, many years. And it was only until 2006 that the interest came back, the first in the United States. But then natural gas prices fell, and now finally there has become lots of interest in China and other places in Asia, and as far as I'm informed, the process has now been marketed in these places. What we learned during these days, and what made me interested in you and all what we have heard about fission trucks, that was that we had a deactivation phenomenon at very low temperatures where the temperature profile would move, and we could identify that as a kind of gum. That is what we have heard a little bit about in the fission trucks. So what we said in a very primitive way, now it's for NAFTA, but it could also be ECO, that you have the rate of absorption, and then you form hydrocarbonaceous species on the surface, they polymerize slowly and form gum, and then you have the reaction that with hydrogen, whether it's CO absorbed or carbon absorbed, you will have a kind of hydrochromic reaction forming the gases. So the activation energy for absorption is roughly 40 kilojoules per mole, and for hydrochromic roughly four times bigger. So what we found for the methanation and also for the pre-reforming reaction, that there is a temperature above which the hydrochromic rate is higher than the absorption rate, and there you do not get this deactivation phenomenon. This, I think, is a general observation. We also saw it in another process we then started work on, and that is in the mobile MCG process, where instead of having polymerization on the surface nickel, you have the blockage of the acidic side of the silver line. But roughly one can say that for this little catalyst, there are conditions in which it will start working as a fission trucks catalyst instead of working as a destination catalyst. And I think it's something which should be explored much more, as we have heard several times. What is the reason that you have this strange behavior with methane in the fission trucks synthesis? So we are never deeper into this with the view to fission trucks. A lot of these observations, I think, are valid for fission trucks conditions as well. Now, we started then to work on a version of the mobile HD process. You know that the mobile process first you have methanol and then you convert the methanol into gas. You lose a lot of energy by condensing and re-evaporating the methanol. And so it was obvious that if you could do things in one process, you would have a huge saving. We did that and had gained the same philosophy to see whether it works. We did it in a small power plant. In making a zero line and to understand the process, we had very great use of the electrical run. It was a very energetic person at that time, and he had a very bright young student, Jean Pierre, the young fellow who gave the talk the first day. So they were really quickly establishing our knowledge base in the company, and there were so then people who became very good in the zero lines. We made a very fast scale-up at this principle to a small-scale plant. And here you see that the Danish Minister of Energy, standing there with dark glasses, he could get the gasoline into his car. The driver was not too happy. He was standing to the left. And the rest of us, we think it's all very good. Hamper called me in the middle of Christmas lunch and said, now we have to scale this up, get some money from the EU and set it up in Houston to demonstrate on data to natural gas that this is good for coal conversion. So that was just a nice assignment. But we couldn't do that at a large scale without having access to the mobile citizen farm. And I had then the meetings with mobile and they were not very much interested, but it's a story by itself. We succeeded that they could supply their cabins and all that. They just wanted some person to go in and see that what we were doing was absolutely crazy. And that person was Heinz Heinemann, and here it is the pilot part. And we had during this very critical period, so I came very close to Heinz, and we became very good friends. But we were then co-chairing a session in the International Conference of Catalysis in Berlin in 1984, and we were sitting at the podium, and we were discussing some paragraphs in this treaty agreement we were about to make with the local company. And suddenly we found out that the mics were open. So, but I don't know whether it got anything from there. So we scaled up quickly and built the pilot plant in Houston. You see the gasoline synthesis that is the plant back. What you see further back, that's not toxic acidity. We only say that if we come out in Asia to talk about the company. The gasoline synthesis was there, and it was operating then extremely well. And I say that Nils Ungar was very instrumental in having this established. But in the operation, we had very very bright technicians, and here you have just three of them. And the one to the right hand side really was our zero light specialist. His name is Nils Blom. He has just a technician education, but he was as bright as any electrician himself. And the two others, they had no academic education, and they did a lot of work. The man to the right is Tommy Hansen. He has been responsible for most large scale plants we have produced. So, in conclusion, if I should look, I could talk about many other technologies, but I worked in the beginning very much on steam reforming, also thermal reforming to syngas. And then later, fission trucks and tie gas to take the syngas back to the hydrocarbons. And so I worked on both sides, and the conclusion is only that It may take 20 years, but one day one of the roots will be in fashion again. Okay, something went wrong. So I would say that all this has been a great experience, and there is still a lot to be explored in catalysis. Now, many of the problems I have described, where I found it took me 20 years really to find a solution. And I'm happy that there are many young people on boats. When I teach in Stockholm, Ankara, other places, I think it's a great pleasure to see how many young people who are still inspired by the problems in catalysis. So I hope this will continue, and being here, listening to all this, I am a little sorry that it's like the old circus horses when you sniff, you can quickly come back and would like to run around. But now it's time for the young people. So thank you for listening, and in the afternoon I will tell a little bit about the lessons from all this, which will be a little more serious thing. Yes?
Thank you. Thank you. It's obviously difficult to sum up 50 years of work in 30 minutes, so you got 40. But it's also a big pleasure to interrupt your old boss and say no. So thank you very much. And I have to say that save your questions to the afternoon, because we are already running out of time. So I'd like to introduce the next speaker, which will tell us about...